I'm going to tell you a little bit about the work we are doing in Denmark, in Aalborg University, developing this model or framework of responsible impact assessment. It's a participatory impact assessment framework that is very much inspired by some of the same ideas that Leonie was telling us about this afternoon. So you will see a little bit of an overlap, but that will only allow me to skip over some of my slides and go more directly into discussion. I'm the head of research of the Humanomics Research Center, which is a center at Aalborg University funded by different foundations and research councils and governments. We are running impact studies of all types of kinds on the humanities, especially also on the social sciences. We have been working for a number of different institutions the last couple of years trying to develop a more sensitive, nuanced, kind of multi-dimensional understanding of what an impact framework within the humanities could look like. I'm in charge and the PI of a project called Mapping the Public Value of Humanities, which is not actually a trivial title because we're also trying to change the vocabulary a little bit away from impact as something very mechanistic, mechanical, very linear into value creation, even making a meaning, making a contribution to society. I think we have had some success advising some of the key European and also Nordic Scandinavian institutions. Often when we talk about impact assessment indicators, we tend to think about biomedical sciences. Those were actually the disciplines who invented the field. Not surprisingly, they also invented the metrics and the indicators that were then later on generalized to other disciplines. So I think, and that's going to be my core argument today, that the only response to that is to do it yourself, develop new local impact theories, preferably participatory indicators, set up your own institutional impact profile, call it impact, something different, but the idea of localizing and making the impact agenda meaningful for the portfolio or the purposes you're set into the world to fulfill is the baseline of what I'm gonna say. We did a very large literature review, which is also available online, on the entire SSH impact literature for the European Commission half year ago, and I can tell you that even though we like or dislike the concept of impact, there are many overlapping ideas out there, like co-creation, co-production, knowledge exchange, knowledge mobilization, knowledge transfer, and even now the European Commission's own idea of open science is also a vehicle or a tool or framework for talking about impact. So we should have an open-minded approach even in the social science and humanities moving forward. Also, that pertains to the literature review and the results we found as well. The idea of actually mapping societal impact becomes an obligatory component in quite a lot of different research evaluation exercises. We've already heard a little bit about the Shambi model, the idea of the productive interactions, but you will find the same in the NSF, at the US, at the Netherlands, in the Dutch community. In Norway, they just yesterday published the national evaluation of the broader impact of social science, and it kind of repeats itself all over the continent. I would say, talking from a Nordic perspective, what we see is that we really do not have any first movers, or we don't have a national framework like in the UK, the REF system, which you're all familiar with. We have a myriad of different initiatives overlapping, competing, trying to get inspired by the type of tools that are available out there. So universities, funding agencies, foundations, charities, and sometimes even the government within specific disciplines are conducting broader impact evaluations. So it is really a topic that is trending in the Nordic countries as well as in almost all other European countries. One of the points of departure for the project that I'm going to talk a little bit about today, Responsible Impact, was that at the university level, we do not have the same track record of actually tracing the broader impact of research. We have a really good track record, at least in the Nordic countries, for tracing publications. Not surprisingly, we have a performance-based funding system in which we get funding for the number of publications we publish, differentiated in the prestige of those journals. We do not have the same in terms of impact assessment, even though it is being tacitly used in giving direction to both funding, career development, and I guess also the accountability overall of our institutions. So that's why we wanted to set out to try to create a university-based evaluation model or assessment model or learning model even that goes beyond only assessing or evaluating the outcomes of individual projects, which are often being demanded by funding agencies. I would also say, and this does definitely not go for Denmark in particular, but for all European countries and I guess all Western countries, that these days the impact agenda is extremely pertinent for the future of democracy. Even there is a considerable dissatisfaction in the way with the way in which science relates to society. We are talking about a post-truth, a post-fact society. We are talking about post-trust, that there is a rising distrust in public authorities, including scientific experts. You have a whole new wave of very aggressive AI algorithms coming up that is going to disrupt part of the labor market. This is all part of the impact agenda. And I guess what Helen will be talking about tomorrow, the idea that the humanities are in some sort of crisis, is also an impact failure or a kind of a mismatch in competence. Interestingly enough, judging from the literature, and this is again kind of part of my argument for making some pushback on this agenda, often the failure of translation is only the failure of academics. We do often not discuss how the capability of absorbing knowledge within practicing communities should be cultivated and developed. That was some of the ideas that also came out of Leone's presentation, that we should cultivate our stakeholders more. It seems that it's all a question about incentives and indicators at the level of higher education institutions. But what we see, this is also the conclusions of the lit review we did for the European Commission, there is multiple interactions and activities cutting across multiple different sectors, call it policy impact, media impact, cultural impact, health impact, environmental impact, many of which goes beyond the established metrics or these simplistic notions, namely primary scientometrics, bibliometrics, and econometrics. So what we are trying to achieve in the project responsible impact is really to kind of widen the horizon or widen the idea of how we could do sensible and responsible impact assessment. I even got a little bit philosophical in my preparing this talk today, saying that often if you don't know what you're looking for, you're only looking for what you know. So this is very much true in terms of setting up impact assessment frameworks, that we are only looking for what can be measured rather than what we want to measure or what might be meaningful to measure. I'll just give you one example and skip over it quite quickly. This graph is taken, which you are probably not able to read, is composed of data from the 2014 REF exercise. That was more than 6,600 impact case studies that were submitted to the UK government. In that corpus, in that data, our colleagues at King's College, Jonathan Grant, found more than 3,700 unique pathways into society. So when you're working with a university or you're working with a patent office or your tech transfer offices and you only have 5 indicators, 15 indicators or 20, it's for sure is not empirically sound. I can say that as a researcher. No matter the diversity and no matter the intensity with which research is penetrating society at almost all levels, we still are kind of caught in the idea of producing PDF files and throwing them into society and hoping that somebody opens our PDF files and actually reads them, which is also not that empirically sound because they often do not get read. If we're really lucky, they will cite our PDF files in their PDF files, and then we have a nice citation network. Interestingly enough, more papers are cited than read. Think about that. So I call this impact assessment in the wild. We do have all these 3,700 different pathways, probably even more. So how do you set up a sensible indicator for the humanities and social sciences? Here I think that the logical model might be a helpful departure. As I will say in a moment, the idea of thinking about impact as a linear process is not sound as well, but it might be helpful in order to get going You start somewhere, you have some resources, there is some input and some planning, and then there is a research process in which you will be able to produce some benefits throughout the research process, which will then end in some outcomes and preferably at some point in some impacts. That kind of the established model. But the moment you start looking into it, you start seeing that we actually know quite a lot about promising impact at the ex ante level. Now with the Leonis tool, we could even get better at coordinating stakeholder interest and value systems in order to look for what types of impacts that would be desirable at the ex ante level. We're also pretty good at looking at impact at the final stage. So that's the moment when people like myself or some kind of stupid consultancy comes in and says, so what came out of it? The moment you close down the project, you're asked to submit a report to some funding agencies, and you only have these five categories of academic paper presentations, journal articles, a book perhaps, and an outreach event for a high school. But what we often do not understand is the whole process. It's all the micro impacts that takes place on the way to the more, let's say, extraordinary, to the grander impacts. And that is why I think really that this model is marginalizing the humanities and social sciences. Often we do not have those big steps, those big leaps forward, like saying, okay, perhaps Michel Foucault kind of gave us a notion of power that we didn't have in advance. That was a breakthrough. But the idea of coming from A to B is really something difficult. But what we do is we do a lot of small baby steps in the way. We produce a lot of knowledge that all the time goes into society, becomes part of the communal belief structure in society. So that's all the small steps I think we should be focusing at. So let's focus on them. There are many, and you can probably add to the list. We invent new methods, new tools, new research questions. We produce artifacts, exhibitions are present in media, public awareness making, social media. We do public conferences. We do stakeholder conferences. We do a lot of educational activities. So there is already in the at the intermediary stage, before the research comes to a close, there is already a lot of outflows or a lot of pathways in which research is translating into impact without really being able to define the final kind of change or effect. So that's kind of the destiny, I think, of the humanities and the social sciences, that the idea of a patent that's being sold or spin-out company that's being bought, where you have a specific number and you can measure it, we're not that much in that kind of high-end impact. We're in the intermediary. We're producing a lot of, in lack of a better word, procedural benefits. Benefits along the way. So that's what we should be focusing at. And as I said a moment ago, I guess that this model of linearity is wrong, so we can put it away and accept that it's all non-linear, circular, and that a lot of these steps are lapping over, and that you can actually already produce research impact before you start a research project. Just by inviting a stakeholder, putting out a press release, or actually just doing a small reception honoring the fact that you got a grant may already be a nice platform for telling somebody outside your project about what you're doing. And that doesn't take too much design, and we can actually even measure it, as I will tell you in a moment. So impact is a function of various small steps and connected efforts rather than those big leaps forward. I think that's kind of the take-home message. Focus more on the micro impacts. We have several of them, and we produced a new data ontology in which we're actually trying to track some of these impacts. I think we are right now up to 108 different pathways that we are co-developing with a population of researchers in Denmark. But it's just fascinating to see how many different types of output are being produced in the humanities that are not being recorded by any impact assessment tool at all. Gunnar Sivertsen, a good colleague of mine, calls this normal impact. So my interpretation of normal impact would be micro impact. He says that the fact that medical faculty is also part of the healthcare system, not only of the university, is a normal impact. So the fact that the medical doctor is sitting in his office or her office in the morning producing a paper, but are actually looking at patients in the afternoon, that's normal impact. It's the transactional mode, the productive interaction with the patients that are producing that type of impact, but that may not add up to this type of what would be the opposite of normal impact, let's call it extraordinary or narrated impact. So that's why we are trying to develop this model of looking at how we start out the scientific practice. So what we do in real time as researchers got to be the foundation of impact assessment. So if you are able to ground your impact assessment tool in scientific practice, you will gain a lot more legitimacy across your faculty, because that will be recognizable as meaningful to the stuff that's actually being done. Then we look at connectivity. So that's all what I call raw relations or micro impacts, interactions, dissemination, communication, engagement, networks. And then on top of that, on top of the connectivity, we can then start building case studies and narratives. So that's why you get this, at least according to our kind of reinvention of this logical model, that's why you should have this feedback loop between normal impact, the everyday practice or the everyday sociology of research, and then those more kind of isolated types of impact. And there is a lot of tools available out there to do that. Unfortunately, we don't know much about connectivity. We do not know much about the micro impacts. If I look at any university website in Europe, I find long lists of publications with extremely esoteric titles. If I'm lucky, I even find a couple of academic presentations at conferences for the really narcissistic researchers like myself. We actually put that into our university information system, but I don't find much data on the micro steps, on the micro impact. So I really think that's where we should be working. Work more on the normal impact, work more on the annotated data, get an idea about how do we move from academia into society, and how do society, at the other hand, move back into academia. And we can actually record it. We did an, in order not to submit ourselves to Elsevier or other companies, we did an open source exercise in which we actually created a data ontology that we ran together, that we are right now running together with 50 researchers, actually putting in all those activities. And I can just give you an example. Again, you can't read our whole taxonomy, but this is the idea, that you have a lot of things that you would be doing as a person. That's over here, that's all the comedy work, that's all the educational activities, that's the censoring, that's all the things you're asked to do but never takes place in a material artifact, but is still quite important when you carry your research into society. And on the other hand, you have the material and textual artifacts. So let me just give you one example of, say, policy impact. What does it mean? Again, it's a very important type of impact for social sciences that are almost not accounted for among any university information systems or impact toolkits. It might be accounted for, as I will close with saying in a moment, in impact case studies, but there it becomes extremely hypothetical. If you start looking at it from a data-oriented or evidence-based point of view, you have a lot of policy outlets in which you can be mentioned or even co-authoring gray literature, green papers, white papers, policy documents, and even for some researchers, law texts. So these are texts that we can now actually do data mining on, and we can actually do citation analysis on gray literature, which has only been possible for a very short period of time. Then there is the stuff you do in person, like the advisory functions. You can be sitting on an ethical committee, you can be working on an advisory board, you can be in a working group, you can just be invited as an expert to give a talk. But again, this is carrying your impact into society. It might not be that big leap forward that everybody can recognize as a major advancement of the ministry or the agency or the company with which you work, but those are micro steps. If we record them, if you can show that a researcher was invited to give 5 talks to the Ministry of Finance, then him or her might have had something relevant to say that you should start looking for the moment you're building case studies. So that would be my suggestion in doing kind of what we could label narratives with numbers. Often impact assessment frameworks are built by narratives without numbers. That's a big problem because it gets very vulnerable to criticism, especially from policymakers who says it's too anecdotal and too much cherry picking. And at the other hand, what they do, the policymakers, they do numbers without narratives. So that's just to present the latest European innovation scoreboard and find out where you're placed. So responsible impact assessment, according to our suggestion, is about striking this balance, have multiple sources of data, use mixed method, do some cluster analysis and think about learning outcomes. So that's pretty important. Let me also say that in concluding here that I really wanted to support Leone's comments that we need to have a greater acknowledgement of the types of impacts that are either negotiated or even sometimes commissioned by the people we work with or for. So that might be universities, their mission statements, their strategies, or it might be the funding agencies and the companies or the research councils, but often there are hidden assumptions that are constantly informing what we mean with impact. And to bring them out and develop your own kind of do-it-yourself indicator from a bottom-up perspective is a way of getting across that, a way of getting around that. Knowledge uptake is a function of interactions among many different academic stakeholders. So for the humanities, I would also always urge them to think about the impact readiness level of the research that's being produced. You have a lot of excellent research that never really makes the big hit, that can never really be in a 4-star RIF case study, because it's not the institutions we work with are not really capable of absorbing that knowledge. That's not the failure of the academic community, it's a failure of the ecosystem. So we should start thinking about the readiness levels also of our community. And then I would say develop these indicators in the wild, drawing on micro impacts. And what we had tried to do at Aalborg was actually to co-design the indicator, a little bit again inspired by the thinking Leone was talking about, with the researchers. So we did a lot of stakeholder involvement. We call it a participatory ontology or participatory taxonomy, in which you start reading CVs, mapping what these people already do in advance, and then talking to the actual subjects, the staff, the academics, the professor, the faculty, about what they do. You actually find quite a rich source of different pathways and impacts at the level of research practice. So before kicking them somewhere at their body and asking them to do something different, I think it's very important that we understand what they already do. And that's where the responsibility of both being participatory and also being inclusive comes into the picture, because including the stakeholders, including the research staff itself in generating a local impact framework, a local impact theory, I think is the first step to get beyond universalizing metrics that are totally not meaningful for humanities or the universities we work in. So thank you for that.